What keeps you from experiencing unconditional peace and joy in life? What is the nature of your mind? Are you the person you think you are in your mind? Would you like to befriend your mind? If yes, I would like to welcome all of you to this session on 5 habits of the mind. Today we are going to see, where does the mind get caught up? Why are we not able to experience the joy and bliss which is there within us? So before we start, let's chant the Guru Mantra. If you know, you can chant along with me. And if not, you may just keep your eyes closed and listen to it. So let's sit tall, eyes closed. Take a breath in and breathe out. Take a long breath in. Gurur Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwaraha, Guru Sakshat Param Brahma, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha, Tasmai Shri Shri Gurave Namaha. And slowly, gently, you may open your eyes. My name is Shampa. I am faculty with the Art of Living organization. And I have been practicing and teaching yoga, Sudarshan Kriya, meditation, and Vedic wisdom for the past several years. Today is a very special day. Millions of people around the world are celebrating this precious ancient practice that we have of yoga. Now, what is yoga? So Maharshi Patanjali, who is known as the founder of yoga, he has defined yoga in these terms. He has said, yoga chitta vritti nirodaha. Yoga, which again means the union of body, mind, soul, this is achieved when the vrittis in the chitta, chitta vritti, vrittis means the modulations in the chitta, in the mind, in the consciousness, nirodaha, they are subdued, they are calmed down. That is when yoga happens. That is when you experience yourself. Now the mind gets caught up in different things. It gets entangled and it is so much outside that it is not able to abide in its nature. So Maharshi says further, he says that there are 5 specific modulations of the mind, 5 habits that the mind can get entangled into. Let's look into all these 5. And of course, I will also discuss what he says, how we can retrace the mind from these modulations and rest in the self. So the first modulation which Patanjali says is the mind is always looking for proof, pramana, he says. It is always searching. It wants proof for anything and everything. So now there are 3 different kinds of proof that the mind might seek. First is direct experience. Suppose you tell me you are in Kolkata. I might ask you, how do you know you are in Kolkata? You say, well, I'm standing in front of the Victoria Memorial. I said, okay, yeah, Victoria Memorial is in Kolkata. That means you are in Kolkata. So the proof that comes from direct experience, pratyaksha. Now the second is anumana, which means you guess, you make a guess. For example, if you see smoke coming up and you guess, you infer that there might be a fire, there must be a fire, that's why the smoke is coming up. So you're not able to see the fire, but by looking at the smoke, you conclude that there must be a fire. This is the second type of proof. And the third is scriptural evidence. You go to a doctor and the doctor prescribes you some medicine and you ask the doctor, how do you know that this is the correct formulation for the condition that I am facing? The doctor will say, well, it is written in the Materia Medica. It is written in the books. Yeah. You cannot say that just because I have not seen World War One does not it means that it did not happen. Historians will say, well, we have all the documents, we have all the evidence that it did take place. Yeah. So the in courts we see that, right? Suppose there is a case, the lawyers will refer to previous cases of similar kind. And what did the judges conclude? How did the judges solve the similar kind of case in the previous years? And they will take that experience, take that learning, and resolve the case at hand. Yeah. So the documented evidence, the documented proof that is there. So these are the three kinds of proof that are there. Now, we need to understand that proof is connected to logic, and the purview of logic is very limited. Whatever can be proved can also be disproved, isn't it? Yeah. For example, the same with love and enlightenment. You know, love, it can be proved and disproved. If someone is making a show of love, doesn't mean that that person is actually feeling that love in real life. What we see in movies, right? Actors and actresses, they display actions of love, but they might not feel it. They might not be feeling it. Now, truth and self is beyond all proof. So this is the first modulation that the mind can get caught up in, always searching for proof. Yes. Now, the second one is viparyaya, which means wrong understanding, wrong perception. Or let's say we can put it this way. You project your own ideas, your own opinions and feelings onto people and things and situations, and you think this is how it is. But it might not be so. I'll give you an example. You go to somebody's house, you knock at the door. The lady of the house happens to open the door. Now, the lady of the house, immediately after she opens, she rushes inside. And you standing at the door, you think, oh, how rude that was. She saw me and she just rushed off. She did not honor me as the guest. In reality, the scenario might be that the lady suddenly remembered that she has put something in the oven and she needs to turn off the gas. Something is burning in the kitchen and she needs to turn off the gas. But what did you think standing at the door? That she disrespected me. How rude of her, right? This happens in life, isn't it? Yeah. For example, you might be calling someone and the person doesn't call back, doesn't respond back, or doesn't receive the call. All kinds of thoughts come to the mind. Why is the person not receiving? Is he or she angry with me? Is he or she thinking like this about me? Yeah. So this is all called viparyaya. Viparyaya means wrong perception. Things are as they are. Things are as they are, but how you view it has nothing to do with the reality. You view it according to your state of mind and your thoughts. Somebody might have an inferiority complex and might feel he or she goes somewhere and might feel that everybody around is arrogant. You know, nobody is respecting me. But that might not be the situation at all. Yes? Do you get what I'm saying? So this is viparyaya. You know, this can really make someone miserable. Yeah, you're constantly in that wrong understanding. Everything, you take it in the wrong sense. Now, the third vritti of the mind, another modulation. So there are five, I said, right? So the third one is vikalpa. Now, vikalpa means hallucination. To put it very simply, daydreaming. Yeah. Now, vikalpa can be of two types. One is pleasurable fantasies. You know, the mind just takes off. You know, what if I was the prime minister of the country? Or what if I got this recognition, this reward? What if these people, you know, they adored me, they loved me, they respected me? What if I had so much fan following? What if? You sit and just you take off. Yes. And there are other kinds of these thoughts, vikalpa, which are baseless fears. You know, you step out of the house and you fear, oh, Suppose I have an accident today, or the person whom I'm going to meet, what if that person doesn't meet me? Or what if, suppose you have to give a presentation and you feel, what if the presentation, you fail to deliver? What if, these are other kinds of thoughts that the mind might get into. Yeah. So this is vikalpa, delusion. So viparyaya is there is something and you understand it in a wrong way. In vikalpa, there is nothing. No such thing is there in real life. And it is your own mind which has taken off. Yeah, which is thinking whatever it wants to think. The mind does get into such thoughts, like, right? Yeah, so this is another modulation of the mind, which is vikalpa. Now, when the mind is not looking for proof, it is not understanding things in the wrong way, and it is not, getting into flights of fantasy, or it is not thinking any baseless fears, then the fourth state of the mind happens. The fourth state of the mind is the mind gets into sleep, nidra avastha. Yeah. So sleep is that condition of the mind when there is no content in the mind. The mind is empty. That is when you are sleeping. This is also a modulation of the mind. And finally, we have the fifth vritti, the fifth tendency of the mind. Yeah. So we have discussed four. What are the four? Quick revision. First is proof, wanting proof all the time. Second is wrong knowledge, wrong perception. Third is delusional, hallucination. Fourth is sleep. Yeah. And the final is smriti, the memory. So what is memory? When the mind is not able to let go of certain things, that when it is stored, it forms memory. For example, you brush your teeth daily. That does not create any impact on the mind, right? Or let's say you have breakfast daily. Suppose I ask you, what did you eat for breakfast a week back? You will say, well, I'll have to think. I don't quite remember. Or let's say, what did you have for breakfast 1 month back? You will say, well, that's impossible to remember. Or if I ask you which color outfit or which outfit did you wear on 5th of January this year? Not possible to remember. So these experiences, these acts we do not remember because the experience was neither painful nor pleasurable. It was something routine that you did. Yeah. But when something is pleasurable or something is painful, it leaves an impression in the mind and that stays. So every pleasurable experience, they create craving in you. And the painful ones, they can create fear, trauma, anger, sadness. Yeah. So what happens, the mind, when the mind is caught up in these vrittis, in these modulations, it is not able to experience this moment. It is not able to be still. It is not centered. It is all over the place, as we say. So how to bring the mind back to its source? How to retract the mind? So Patanjali Maharshi, he gives two solutions. He says there are two ways. One is abhyasa, practice. What is abhyasa? Practice. So practice that brings steadiness, that brings that centeredness. You see, whatever skill you want to acquire, you need to practice. We all agree with this, right? For example, if you want to become a good sitar player, you will need to practice playing the sitar. If you want to be a good cook, you need to cook, right? So everything needs practice. Yes. Now, how should the practice be? So Maharshi says further, he says that the practice should be for a long time. Satu dirgha kala, for a longer period of time. And nairantarya means it should be daily. Somebody might say, well, I'm practicing music for the past 10 years. And you probe deeper and the person might say, well, once a month I practice. Not that. Nairantarya means practicing on a daily basis, being regular, consistent with your practice. Sattu dirgha kala nairantarya satkara sevita. Now it is not enough to practice and practice consistently. The attitude towards your practice also matters a lot. Yeah. So when we practice with that honor, with that respect and a sense of gratefulness, we get better results. Am I making sense? How you practice is directly proportional to what you get out of that. You know, how proficient you become in that, how skilled you become in that. So practicing with that honor. Drira bhumi, which means that when you practice for a longer period of time, consistently, with honor, then it gets firmly established. Then you are firmly established in yourself. Then you don't get easily shaken by whatever is happening in the world, by whatever is happening in your own mind. Yeah. Now, these five vrittis that we discussed just now, you cannot do away with them completely. You know, you cannot do away with sleep, right? Yeah. But then too much or too less of each of these vrittis can create pain. Too much of sleep, it is not good. Too less sleep, it's painful. You know, if you are not able to remember anything, if there is nothing in your memory, you won't be able to function. And on the other hand, if you are unable to forget anything, that is also painful, isn't it? Now, how to manage the vrittis? That is what we are discussing. Yeah, we cannot remove them altogether. So how to keep them in check, keep them in control? So one is abhyasa, practice. Your practice will really help you. Yes, and giving top priority to your practice. Yes, this is one thing. You know, Gurudev Shri Shri Ravi Shankar Ji, he often says that we learn many things in life, right? We acquire our qualifications. But one thing we do not learn, neither at home or in school, is how to manage our own mind, how to manage our own emotions. What is the nature of our mind? Who am I? So these are things that we do not learn anywhere. This is also a skill, the skill to manage your mind, the skill to manage different situations in life. Various situations come, right? And opposite situations come many times. Whatever you are used to, the complete opposite happens. For example, right now, you know, the pandemic, the lockdown that we are going through, this is a completely opposite situation to what we were used to even 1.5 years back. We are all locked in. We are working from home. We are not able to go out. Yeah, so many things. So how to manage the mind when such opposite situations come? How to take care of the mind when it is too much caught up in one of these modulations? Your practice will surely help you in this. Yes, your practice of meditation, your practice of yoga. Yes, listening to some wisdom every day. So this can really, really help you to keep that balance in the mind, to strengthen the mind, to go through the different situations, to bring that equanimity in the mind. So this was about abhyasa. Now, abhyasa alone is not enough. There is one more aspect that we need to pay attention to, which is vairagya. Now, Gurudev Shri Shri Ravi Shankar Ji, who is also the founder of Art of Living organization, he says, if there is one term that has been grossly misunderstood, it is this word, vairagya. Often we think that vairagya means not wanting anything. You know, it is just running off and not taking care of yourself, wearing maybe torn clothes, you know, being disabled, unclean, yeah. So, and being depressed, you know, moving around with a long face, that we think is vairagya. No, that is not vairagya. That can be the sign of depression, but it is definitely not vairagya. Vairagya is relaxing this grip, the strong grip that we have over, you know, our cravings and aversions, relaxing that grip in the mind. Relaxing that grip on the sense pleasures that we have. Too much attachment to our own cravings and aversions, to the things that is happening in the mind. Just relaxing that and just reposing in yourself. That is Vairagya. And Vairagya gives you so much energy and enthusiasm and joy. You know, Adi Shankaracharya, a famous saint in India, he had said, Kasya sukham na karoti viraga, which means there is no joy that Vairagya does not bring you. There is no joy that this passion does not give you. So in life, we need both, right? We need passion as well as dispassion. Now, if you have only passion, then you are in for trouble because not every wish will get fulfilled at the time that you want. Some desires, some wishes take time to fulfill. At time you need dispassion. That time you need to let go also, isn't it? In fact, if you only have passion and no dispassion, you won't even get proper sleep at night. The mind will be reeling with all the things that you want. So in life, we have learned this habit early on, the habit of, you know, acquiring, possessing. We need to learn this habit of letting go also when it is needed. That brings so much relaxation and freedom at the level of the mind. Yes, so that is Vairagya. You know, having a broader view of life. You know, Gurudev again says, I really love this these words that he says. He says, the world is here for your enjoyment. Enjoy the world. But while enjoying, do not forget the self. Yeah. So coming back to the self, you know, being contented, operating from that space of contentment. Of course, you have to do whatever you need to do in life. All the goals we need to achieve, all the things we need to do in life. But what is the state of your mind? Are you frustrated as you achieve your goals, or are you doing that from the space of contentment and happiness? Yes, so that is Vairagya. Just letting go of that strong, tight grip that we have and relaxing in yourself. Yes. So this was about the five vrittis, the five modulations of the mind, and the ways that we can calm the mind, that we can free the mind of all the feverishness and let it rest in itself. And when it rests in the self, that is when it experiences the bliss and the peace and the joy. So I leave you with these words. You can contemplate on these words. And if you want, you can take some time out and read the Patanjali Yoga Sutras. Very beautifully, Maharshi Patanjali has spoken. You know, our ancient rishis, they were all scientists, I tell you. You know, the more you read them, the more you're fascinated. What depth of knowledge these scriptures have. You know, how deeply they have gone into the human psyche, and what profound insights they have brought forth. And when we have a spiritual master like Gurudev Sri Sri Ravi Shankar Ji, who has explained these often difficult to understand texts, you know, who have explained this the sutras in a very relevant way, something that you can relate. And what happens when you are able to understand the context, when you are able to feel that, oh, this is what happens. Oh, this is what I am going through right now. You are able to, you know, this broadens your awareness of your own life and your mind. And the wisdom is integrated into the life. Otherwise, it remains something just in the scriptures, isn't it? Yes. So this much from me. Welcome to read the Patanjali Yoga Sutras. And once again, wish everyone happy International Yoga Day. May all of us incorporate yoga and the yogic wisdom in our day-to-day lives. Thank you.